About 10 years ago, Abhijit Banerjee and I wrote a book, which was quite a natural book for us to write, because it was trying to step back from the day-to-day of our work to see the beautiful picture that emerged when you look at many, many projects together, and try to understand a little bit better how the poor around the world live their lives. And to our surprise, this book found something of an audience. We were quite happy to have gotten away with it, but we were pretty clear that we were done. Because economists do not write books, at least they don't write books that anybody would like to read. And so we thought we should go back to our day job, which is to do research projects on various aspects of how people live their life and run experiments and sometimes talk to government. So this is what we were doing when the sort of hope that existed in the Obama era was replaced by an anxious conversation, both in Europe and in this country, and also to some extent in India, where we spend a lot of our time. And we saw that this conversation was surprising in two ways. First of all, because it's extremely polarized. And in particular, it's very easy to guess what someone will tell you about more or less any subject, as long as you know their answer to about three subjects. And that's not a good thing. And the second thing is that a lot of the topic that people are arguing about have a lot of economics in it. People are worried about immigration. People are worried about trade. People are worried about inequality. People are worried about climate change. And all of those are issues on which there is actually a lot of economics work. But nobody trusts economists to answer these questions. That was our feeling at the time. This was also the feelings, for example, of our British colleagues who were a part of the Brexit debate and nobody wanted to have anything to do with. And that feeling was shown to be real when there was a poll done in the UK by YouGov, which asks people, which kind of experts do you trust about their own field of expertise? So the most trusted people are nurses and doctors. The least trusted people are politicians. That's maybe not that surprising. But second to the bottom come economists. And I'm not saying that you should trust economists about dating or about football. People do not trust economists about economics. Only 25% of people trust economics when they talk about economics. And about half, 50% of people do trust weather people. So the trust in weather people is twice as high as the trust in economists. So you might think, well, whatever, you know, serve them right, that's your problem. And after all, what's the big issue? But of course, as economists, you feel slightly bothered by that. And beyond that, the problem is if nobody trusts weather people about the weather or nobody trusts economists about economics, it means that the conversations that we are having about those issues that are essentially economic issues is a little bit devoid of substance. And when a conversation is devoid of substance, what replaces it are emotions. And then this is when debates become polarized. It is also when people become despondent, because if there is no facts or no substance to substantiate an argument, then you don't have a sense that you can solve the issue. And if you don't have a sense that you can solve the issue, then you get even more depressed and even more upset and even more polarized. So then we thought, well, maybe we should try and get in and try to bring in try to kind of modestly say, what have economists said about some of these issues? But to start with, we were kind of reflecting why nobody trusts economists in the first place. And I think there are two reasons for that. The first one is that most people think economists are mostly in the business of doing forecasts about what the economy is going to be in the future. If you're an economist and you've ever been in a taxi, the first thing that the taxi driver asks you is what's going to happen to the stock market. And I don't know what's going to happen to the stock market. In fact, I don't even put my money in the stock market, which every economist tells you you should, but I'm not organized enough to get around to do it, so I'm the last person to tell you what's going to happen to the stock market. More generally, even the professional people whose job is to make predictions are extremely bad at it. So the IMF put together a paper to show how good the IMF was at predicting recessions. And in recessions, on average, the economy shrinks by about 3%. 1 year before the recession, the predictions of the IMF is that the economy is going to grow by 5%. 6 months before the recession, the IMF predicts that the economy is going to grow by 3%. Within the recession year, 3 months into the recession year, the IMF still thinks that the economy is going to grow by 1%. In October of that year, finally, the prediction growth becomes about minus 1% when the real growth is actually minus 3%. This is a paper that's put together by the economists, so it's not controversial what I'm saying. We are lousy at prediction. We are absolutely terrible at forecasting. We are much worse at forecasting than weather people at forecasting the weather. So, of course, if you think economists are forecasters, then you shouldn't trust economists. But then it turns out most people in economics are not forecasters. In fact, the research that you see in economics department doesn't usually make prediction. It's trying to kind of slowly, gently, little by little, step by step, understand how people behave, why they behave the way they do, and what this implies for some little corner of the economy. And that economics is very, very quiet. Most of these people don't particularly like to talk. In fact, the only economists that you hear that are in the media are people who are usually have kind of narrow opinion. The vast majority of economics is not particularly ideological. It doesn't have very strong views, but it has a lot of knowledge. And what we felt is, okay, maybe it is time to be a voice for that. So we decided to kind of take a year or two off of our normal day job and to read other people's work on this topic that we don't necessarily work on. Immigration and trade and growth and climate change and inequality. And to try to see what we have learned, what we know, what we don't know, what might be some directions in which collectively we could try to go on to improve at least the dialogue and maybe to come up with some solutions. So I'm not going to summarize what we found, but I'm going to give you four lessons very briefly that run throughout all of these topics and that are helpful to analyze all of them and maybe some more that you might come across later on. And those are messages that are probably very, very different than the one you've heard if you've taken Economics 101 or 102 or even 103 in college. So they are useful to keep in mind. The first one is that people, us, individuals are much less sensitive to financial reward and incentive that economists typically will assume. So what we tend to see, what we see in our you know, basic textbooks is the idea that, okay, if the wages are higher, then you're going to work harder. On the other hand, if someone guarantees you a minimum standard of living, then you're going to work less hard. And if the taxes are higher, then people are going to stop working. Now, this is an idea that is so intuitive that most people have really bought into it. So we did a survey of about 10,000 people in the US and we asked them, what do you think, if the taxes were higher, do you think other people would stop working? And they're all saying, yes, yes, yes. If the taxes were higher, people would stop working and move away and evade taxes. But then we also asked half of the people, instead of asking about other people, we asked them about yourself. Suppose the taxes were higher, would you stop working? And people say, of course, no. Suppose there was a minimum guaranteed income, would you stop working? No, no, I would not stop working. So in reality, people, when they think about themselves, think that they are not that sensitive to incentives because the reason why we live as human beings is not actually primarily for financial gains, although, of course, everybody needs enough to feed their family. But then beyond that, what you look from your professional position is social connection, is a sense of purpose, is a sense of meaning in life. And people are looking for that in their lives and therefore in their jobs, which is what we spend a lot of time on. And it turns out that people's self-awareness about themselves is much closer to the truth than what they think is happening to other people. And in particular, when states have either decrease taxes or increase taxes, you never see a response that somehow if the taxes decrease, suddenly people work so much harder, or if the taxes increase, they all go home and stop working. And in particular, when poor people are being offered social protections, when the social protection become more generous, either with social programs or with cash transfer program, you never see people stopping to work in response to that. Even in situation where those money is taxed away as people start working. So people will get to work, even though as they work, they lose social benefits. Because the social connection and the position in life you get from working is so much more important than the money in some sense. That's the first lesson, and it runs throughout. The second lesson, which is connected, relates to migration. So if people were extremely sensitive to financial incentive, then the moment the wages are a little bit higher, they will all go there. And this is a worry that we have when we're looking in our other countries and we're thinking, oh, if the borders were open, everybody would come here. So if you're a generous person, you think, fine, I'm willing to take the cost because, you know, our lives is so much better, we should welcome people. Or if you're not so generous, you think, therefore, we should really close the borders because that's going to, this influx of people are going to threaten our civilization, plus the wages are of our less well-off people. But the fact is, even in situations when the borders are completely free, for example, within the US, people just do not move. Today in the US, the geographical mobility is as low as it had ever been. It is about half what it was in 1948. In 1948, in every year, 14% move from one county to the other. And today it's about 6%. So even within the US where nothing stops you, people do not move. Across borders where a lot of things stops you, that's of course even lower. So people don't move. Resources don't move either. So the economy is much, much more sticky than we think. So the first consequence is that there is no reason to be scared of migration. There is not going to be a wave. The second consequence is that we cannot expect the natural flow of people and money, etc., to undo the vast disparity in economic situation from one place to the other. In particular, if people lose their job in North Carolina because of trade, for example, it is not easy for them to move to New York because they were making furniture in North Carolina and they can move selling furniture in New York. The fact is that transition either does not happen, or if it happens, it's extraordinarily costly. The third lesson is that we might be putting a little too much emphasis on the notion of preferences. So economists have a very strong idea that we should not discard tastes. So we might personally dislike other people's preferences, but we are not to argue with them. Preferences are something which are deeply ingrained in people. They are constituting of who they are. And they are a thing. So if people behave in a way that you find distasteful, you cannot argue with their taste. Maybe you change the environment to make it more costly to behave in this distasteful way. What does that mean? Well, it means, for example, that fighting climate change would be very, very difficult because if people really, really love to drive in very, very big cars, then who are you to stop them? And the only way we can do that is by making gasoline very, very expensive, but that's going to make them very unhappy. Another consequence is that it becomes very difficult to fight xenophobia or bigotry of racism because you cannot really have a conversation on preferences. Preferences are what they are. Now, in fact, in reality, preferences, even what you express about things as mundane as vanilla versus chocolate ice cream, are as important as what you think about the climate or what you think about people from other nations or from other racial groups, is actually something which is, number one, people don't necessarily very strongly held preferences, even if they express them in a very extreme way at a moment in time. They can be more fleeting than you think. So even notions of identity are more easily manipulable than one might think. And the second thing is that they are, of course, very, very influenced by your experience and your social experiences. I'll just give you one example, which is kind of anecdotal example, but drives the point home. So a group of researchers in Switzerland invited a bunch of bankers, Swiss bankers, to the lab. And they made them play a game which involved throwing a coin 50 times and writing down head every time they got head. And then they got paid as a function of heads that they found. And nobody was watching them. So of course, if nobody watches you and you have a chance to make a little more money by finding a little bit more than 50-50, then you might report a little bit more heads. And in fact, when people play this game, people tend to cheat a bit. In fact, it's funny because if in fact you observe people from behind a fake mirror, you can see that it's not that they just write down the number that they want, it's that they throw the coins a little more until it gets them the result that they expect. So it's like kind of working hard at it. So anyway, in this case, the Swiss banker came into the lab and half of them asked them to think about their day in the office. And they asked them to think about the weekend with their family. So in one case, they sort of activated this idea that you are a banker. In the other case, they activated this identity that you are a family person. And then they played the game. And the people whose identity as family people has been activated did not cheat at all. They have exactly 50-50. And the people who are just the same banker that just happened to be randomized in one situation or the other cheated at a much higher rate, about 75% of them cheated. So that means that even something as deep as our identity and our behavior is affected by what is activated at a moment or another. Which means, for example, that when you're having conversation with people, how this conversation is going to go depends a little bit on how you started. Because that's going to activate the identity of that person at that time that comes to the forefront, which is something much less deep than we tend to assume and ascribe on people. If you start a conversation with someone by saying, oh, by the way, you are xenophobic, then it's kind of going to harness people into that conversation. So there is one, the fourth lesson is that there is one exception to this idea that we don't feel very strongly about preferences, is that one preference that people seem to have across the board is that they care much more about dignity than about anything else. So dignity is both your position in the social network, your position vis-a-vis your friend, whether or not you have friend at all, also your sense that your life is meaningful or is not. And when you have very rich people, dignity is whether you're making more money than others. The level doesn't matter that much, but you want to be the highest paid person. When you have poor people, it's, for example, very, very, very poor people in India, it's the sense of being able to provide for your family. People in this country is often associated to your position in the community plus the meaning that you take out of your job. So dignity is fundamental into the happiness that people experience and how they live their life as a consequence. The problem is that our policies have sort of ignored that the key importance of dignity in people's well-being. So for example, if we think of trade, we're thinking, well, you know, trade will hurt some people, but a lot maybe, but then it will help a lot of people a little bit. So we should be willing to compensate the people who are hurt because we can all buy furniture a little bit cheaper. Except that we forgot the fact that the transitions are so difficult because they go with this loss of dignity. The other thing that we forgot is that our social protection systems are mostly inherited from a Victorian era where we did think of anybody who needs the potential social help as someone who is potentially lazy or potentially a grifter, and therefore someone that we should be wary of. Someone that for their own protection, we should really encourage to get a grip with their life and get organized. So in the Victorian era, they put poor people in prisons. And today we don't, But we kind of make it evident, abundantly clear that if you need help at a moment or another, it is your fault. And therefore, you should get out of it as quickly as possible to retain your dignity. Now, you can see how there is this huge tension between the fact that people get hurt, like deeply hurt, by things that have nothing, that is absolutely not in their control, which is, for example, losing their job in the furniture factory and not wanting to move. And the fact that the social protection system is putting so much, has so much suspicion for them. And these two things create the type of social anxiety, which is not just economic anxiety, which is social anxiety and identity anxiety, that creates the conversation or the lack of conversation that we're having today. So I think you take these four ideas and then you can now apply them to anything you're thinking about, like trade and climate change and social protection. And we'll give you some sense about how to think about these ideas. I hope you're having a wonderful night. Being here together and starting to talk is a good start. And I wish you the best of year as well. Bye-bye.